John chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. John chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, we thank you, Lord, for this yet another opportunity to preach and teach your gospel.
Yes, yes.
I ask now, Lord, that you send Holy Ghost power down in this place.
Yes, yes.
Lord, that lives may be changed.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
And Lord, that none of us will leave up out of here the same way that we came
Hallelujah.
In.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let the words of my mouth and the
thank
meditation
you,
of my heart
yes. Thank you, God.
Be acceptable in thy sight, O yes. Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Yes.
And all of God's people said, Amen.
Amen.
John chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. Are you there?
Yes.
After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up to the mountain and sat there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said, "It's the test, for he himself knew what he was going to do." Philip answered, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." And there was a great deal of grass in the place. So they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This indeed is a prophet who is coming to the world." I want to use for a subject, they had it, but they hid it. They had it, but they hid it. As students of the Bible, we should know this miracle of the feeding of 5,000, not counting women and children, is the only miracle of Jesus that is recorded in all 4 of the Gospels. Matthew 14, Mark 6, Luke 9, and where we are today in John chapter 6. And scholars would suggest to us that the importance of this miracle being recorded in all 4 Gospels is that they all should know about this miracle with 5 loaves of bread and 2 pieces of fish. So it seems that it's more important that Jesus is walking on water, more important than giving sight to blind Bartimaeus, more important than the women with the issue of blood, and even more important than raising Lazarus from the dead, is the message and the miracle and the ministry of what Jesus does right here in feeding 5,000 people. And that tells us in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all came to the same conclusion, that the gospel message is not complete until Jesus feeds the 5,000. Because it's in this moment that we find out that he is a caring and a concerned Christ who tends to the situations in our lives. It's in this moment that we find a Savior who proves that no matter how late we are in our lives, that he can still provide for all of our needs according to his riches and his glory. It's in this moment that he reminds us that no matter the size of our problem that we face, that God, our God is a way maker, a problem solver, and can do anything but fail.
Amen.
And it reminds us that we would just take a little time that we had and put it in God's hand and learn to be thankful for whatever it is,
yes,
that God can supply all our needs.
Amen.
But y'all, there's something about the feeding of the 5,000 that we ought to take note of today, because it happens at the climax of Jesus' earthly ministry. Because at this time on the Sea of Galilee, there are 5,000 men. And if we count the women and the children, there are somewhere between 12,000 and 15,000 people who are following Jesus.
Amen.
So this is the height of his miracle. But if we follow Jesus through the Gospel of John, we'll find out that not only is the height of his ministry, but it's also the turning point of his ministry. Because there's something that Jesus does in the feeding of the 5,000 that lays the foundation for him to teach about discipleship. But because of what he teaches here, the Bible says that he's rejected by his own people, and the multitude no longer follows him. So y'all, there's something that Jesus does in feeding of the 5,000 that made people walk away and to follow him no more. Because the feeding of the 5,000 is not just about a miracle-making God. It's not just about a sovereign Savior. It's not just about a caring Christ. But the miracle also gives us the expectation about how we ought to give to the Lord. Because if we go beyond our Sunday school reading of this text, we'll see that it's not just about a God who meets our needs, but it's a question about how we live and how we offer and how we sacrifice and how we bring to the Lord what the Lord has already blessed us with.
Amen.
So it's not surprising that people stop following Jesus after this miracle. Because one thing that we don't like talking about in church is giving. Because tithing sermons don't bring the crowds to church. Because nobody wants to be told what to do with the resources that God has given them. But if I were to preach about your miracle was on the way, and that the blessings of the Lord were on the way,
yes,
this church would be packed out.
Yes.
And as a matter of fact, there's somebody in here right now trying to figure out how you can slide up out of here. Because you didn't get up this early on a Sunday morning to hear the preacher talk about your resources,
yes,
and giving and tithing,
yes,
and sacrificing and sowing, because that's not what you came here to hear. But you want me to shout me and tell you that everything is going to be all right. But y'all, the truth is that sometimes that we limit what the Lord wants to do in our lives by how we handle what God has already given us. So when we get to the Sea of Galilee, we can learn a lesson about what the Lord expects from us, and how we do with what we have determines what the Lord is going to do for us. Because when we put together this story from all of the Gospels,
yes,
we'll find that it has been a long day for Jesus and his disciples.
Yes.
And they've been ministering in Galilee, which is Jesus' hometown. And lives have been changed. People are giving themselves to the Lord. The sick have been healed. Demons have been cast out. Blinded eyes have been opened, and everything is good. And Jesus decides to pull his disciples out of the crowd, to spend a long time in prayer, and to separate them from the dangers that come along with success. So he pulls them away, because the applause of the people will sometimes mislead us. And he brings them together to sail across the Sea of Galilee, only to find out the crowd that was with them in Galilee is not ready for ministry to be over. So while Jesus and the disciples are sailing across the sea, the people are running along the seashore to meet them at their destination. And the Bible says that when they land on the other side, that at least 5,000 men have run along the seashore. And they ask Jesus for some more ministry, some more healing, some more deliverance, and some more miracles. And even though Jesus and the disciples are tired, the Bible says that Jesus has compassion on them. So ministry starts again. They were supposed to be done, but Jesus sees that there's still some sick that need to be healed. There's some blind eyes that need to be opened. There's still some people that still want to hear the word of God. So Jesus starts round two, even though he and the disciples are tired. And y'all, in the middle of the ministry, a problem comes up because the sun starts to go down. It's late in the day. They're in the middle of the desert with no buffets or grocery stores to be found. So it's been a long day for everybody. It's late. There's no food. And the disciples realize that the people are not getting hungry. Now, if you ain't ever been hungry, Hunger is when your blood sugar drops because you're that hungry. And you start getting mad at the same time. So this crowd has gotten hungry. The disciples are hungry. And everybody is mad. And Jesus decided that he's going to handle. And he wants to feed. He wants to make a way. He wants to provide. But there's some people in the crowd who try to get in the way of what he can do. And y'all, if we hang out with this crowd, I want to show you three types of people who not only get in the way of what the Lord wants to do in their lives, but they get in the way of what the Lord wants to do in the body of Christ. Amen. And I know that y'all ain't going to shout today, but I'm going to teach this anyway. So let me share with you some people who are always problematic. Because verse 2 tells us that a large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing. Which means that when Jesus got in the boat to sail over, that they were already in the house. But when they got there, all they have is 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. So y'all, these people have run all the way from Galilee, and all they have is 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Now y'all stay with me, because I want to suggest to us that this can't be an issue of being needy, but this has to be an issue of being trite. Because how you going to run all the way from your house to follow Jesus, and you don't bring nothing on your journey? And it's not because they didn't have anything, but it's because they chose not to bring anything. Because they thought that following Jesus ought to be free. So in this relationship, he's supposed to give to us, but we don't have to give anything back to him. And the sad thing about it is that they came to worship empty handed. And y'all, on every row, in every crowd, there's somebody who believes in following and receiving. But they don't believe in sacrifice and giving. Because they believe that following Jesus ought to be free. Now y'all, here's what messed me up. Because they ran to the other side of the sea. And they expected Jesus to be there. But they came empty-handed. They expected the disciples to work overtime. But they came empty-handed. They expected to see some more miracles happen. But they came empty-handed. They showed up believing that they could hear the service again on 104.5. But they came empty-handed. They expected the musicians to be ready and the choir to sing good, but they came empty-handed. They expected the pastor to be present and to be preaching good that service, but they came empty-handed. They expected Sunday school and Bible study materials, but they came empty-handed. They expected the church to funeralize their mama and their daddy with fried chicken and soft rolls after the funeral, but they came empty-handed. And y'all, it's a sad thing when you worship around people who expect everything from God, but they keep coming empty-handed. Because our discipleship should demand our stewardship. Our faith should affect our finances. Because our worship is not our warfare. And the church is not free sanctified entertainment. And part of our commitment and call as disciples is to bring what the Lord has already blessed us with. Because don't none of us own nothing. Now I already know that some of y'all are mad. And you saying that everybody can't tithe. And y'all, I get that. That y'all don't want to hear about money. But when you get home, I want you to read Mark 12. And you'll find this little old lady comes to put her 2 pennies in the offering. And the miracle is not that she gave 2 little cents. But the Bible says that Jesus was watching how people gave when they worshiped. So y'all, Jesus came to church. And he watched the offering. And y'all, what that told me is that the Lord didn't close his eyes when it's time for us to tithe and give it all. So this ain't where we can do what we want to do. Because yes, the Lord wants us to worship and wake up on Sundays saying this is the day that the Lord has made. Yes, God wants us to get dressed on Sunday mornings and say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes, the Lord wants us to enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise and be thankful to him and to bless his name. But y'all, our worship is always incomplete if we don't ask, what shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits and his blessings and all his goodness towards me? Amen. So if we bring our Sunday best, if we bring our bodies, if we bring our families, but we don't bring our own, we come empty-handed. And part of the reason that the church is limited is there are always too many people who come empty-handed on purpose. Because in Matthew's account of this story, it said the disciples told Jesus to send the multitudes away. So they go to the villages, and they buy themselves some food. So tell them to take their money, spend it on their own needs. But we shouldn't encourage them to bring it to you. Because in every Christian crowd, there's somebody who believes that the money that you have the freedom to spend it like you want to spend it. So we come holding back our tithes and our offering because we believe that there's something else that we can take care of. And there's another bill that we need to pay. So instead of bringing it to the Lord, we believe that we can do more than 10% of paying our bills that we can do with giving to God and trust that God to supply all our needs. And y'all, ain't it something how creative we get with our money for the things that we want and need to do. But when it comes time to give to God, we want to negotiate and go around. Because we didn't have a problem finding money for that purse. We saved up the money to go to the beach. Walmart always gets our money. You didn't have a problem finding money going to the ABC store Friday night. Yeah, I saw y'all. And it's funny because we become majors in math. But we want to do what we want to do. But when it's time to give back to God, we want to God please and negotiate. And we give ourselves a pass, saying that I have bills to pay. I got student loans to pay, y'all. And we hold back from the Lord because the devil has convinced us that we can do better taking the 10% that we're supposed to give God and applying it to the bills that we already have. But let me tell y'all to hold in that argument so that can change your mindset for next Sunday. Because the Lord can only bless what we bring. And if we bring nothing, he can't bless nothing. Now let me prove that to you. Because in John 6, he says, I am the bread of life. At the Lord's Supper, he broke bread. But the one time that we see Jesus not trying to control bread is in the wilderness when he was tempted by Satan. And Satan says to him, you see these stones, so turn them into bread. And when Satan points out these stones, Jesus doesn't do it. But when bread is brought to him on the Sea of Galilee, he uses the power to multiply. Yes. And y'all, the question that I had to ask is why didn't Jesus use his power to turn the stones into bread in the wilderness? But he used his power to multiply it on the Sea of Galilee. Because why not use your power to turn stones into bread? But you use your power to multiply it to feed 5,000. And y'all, part of that is that Satan showed up and he showed him the stones, but he didn't put them in Jesus' hand. But on the Sea of Galilee, there's a little boy that said, take my bread, because this boy gave it to the Lord, and the Lord can multiply it. Because if we just show it to God, all he's going to do is look at it. But if we put it in his hand, he can multiply it in ways that we never saw coming. And this was somebody who's always complaining about your financial situation. Lord, look at my bills. Lord, look at my arrears. Lord, look at my troubles. And God says, you got to know that I've already seen all that. But until you put it in my hand, and until we bring that offer and give that tithe, we haven't given the Lord anything to multiply. Now, y'all, here's what messed me up. Because when the disciples told Jesus to send the people away, what they're really saying is, Lord, you got to bring an end to this ministry. Stop teaching. Stop healing. Stop delivering. And send these folks home. So they can use their money somewhere else. Because when the disciples decide to take what the Lord has given us and to use it elsewhere, it's always going to announce the end of our ministry. So the church gives her benediction when the disciples decide that I'm going to spend my money where I want to spend it. Because we don't just give to bless our own lives. But we also need to support what the Lord is doing for everybody. Amen. And when the disciples decide not to give, but to spend somewhere else, we're telling the church to stop doing what she's doing. Because if you don't give, we can't feed 5,000. If you don't give, we can't give away school supplies and book bags. If you don't give, we can't afford good musicians and quality preachers. If you don't give, stop bragging about what your church is doing. If you don't give, stop complaining about what your church ain't doing. Because you ain't invested in it nowhere. And you ain't got a dog in the fight. But if you do give, you can see the work of the Lord. And what the Lord is doing in the church. Because when we decide not to give, we're telling the Lord to stop what he's doing. So we have a group that came empty-handed. We have a group that wants to spend that money somewhere else. And then there's a group that we really have to keep our eyes on. Because watch verse 5. When Jesus looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him.
Yes, sir.
He said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?"
Uh-huh.
So Jesus tells the disciples to go out and see what we have. Go see how much food is out there. Find out what the people brought with them.
Yeah.
Find out how good God has been to them. Find out what they have that they know that they shouldn't have. And y'all, the Bible says that after they questioned 12,000 to 15,000 people, that the only thing that they came back with was 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish.
Yeah.
Now I gotta tell y'all what really happened. Because I know disciples,
right.
I know followers, and I know church folks.
Because
you can't convince me that in a crowd of 15,000 people, that there were only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. But here's what I believe happened. The disciples asked, and both of them said, "I ain't giving them Negroes nothing." So they had it, but they hid it. So they didn't come with nothing. But they decided, "I ain't giving nothing today." And what would cause somebody who's so blessed by God to make a decision that you ain't gonna give back to God? How can you even be a receiver of God's blessing and decide what the Lord asks you to do that you ain't gonna do? And how can you sit in church on a Sunday morning and say that you're not gonna give and you just gonna disobey God? But let me tell y'all what I think really happened. Because some people didn't give. Because they said that they got some other people out there with money. So my little bit ain't gonna matter.
Right.
So we moved away to the ministry to 20% of the people to do 100% of the work. And we excuse ourselves because we say they don't need my money.
Right.
But y'all, there's a little boy that said, "I may not have much, but the little bit that I have, the Lord is able to use to make a difference." Because the size doesn't matter, but the sacrifice does. And the Lord wants us to give from our hearts because we trust God. Now, if that's not your reason for giving, maybe this might be it. Because I can promise you that somebody in the crowd said that I'm not going to give. Because I voted against us coming out here anyway.
Woo!
I was at work doing the business meeting. And they shouldn't be making decisions if everybody wasn't there to fuss about it. So since I voted against it, and since I wasn't there, I ain't giving up. Okay, that's not you. Let me see if I can find it. Because somebody said, "I ain't giving because Peter asked. And I don't like people. And Matthew owes me some money anyway. And since I don't like the disciples, I ain't going to give them nothing." But what answer are we going to give God for why we didn't give?
Yes.
Now watch the text, y'all. Because verse 11 tells us, "And Jesus took the loaves. And when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples. And the disciples are those who are sitting down. And likewise of the fish, as much as they want." So whatever we do, what God calls us to do, he always does more than we expect him to do. And I need somebody to help me close right up in here, who's enjoying some blessings that you ain't even asked for. Because the Lord has let some stuff happen in your life that you didn't even expect. Because you asked for one thing, but the Lord gave you 10 more things. Because that's what happens when you put it in his hand. Because he's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask. And I need somebody who knows that you can appreciate God's goodness in your life. And the blessings that he just keeps giving. Because you didn't come to him empty-handed. And the Lord has given you as much as you want. So whatever you need from the Lord right about now, all you got to do is ask.
Because
he's got what you need. But we have to just have enough faith to ask
and
do what he tells us to do. And don't worry about what it looks like. But just do what God tells you to do. Don't worry about what it feels like. But just do what God tells you to do. And God is going to turn it around. Is there anybody here this morning who didn't come here empty-handed today? But you showed up believing that God knows your address. God knows your zip code. God knows what you're going through. And he will show up if you put it in his hand. That's why you shouldn't come to God empty-handed. Because he didn't laugh to let you leave. That's why you shouldn't come empty-handed. Because you got too much to be excited about. And the Lord is looking for somebody this morning who didn't come to church empty-handed. Because the Lord has given you some stuff that you ain't even asked for. Bless you with some stuff that you wasn't even looking for. And if the Lord has opened some doors for you this morning, and you're not ashamed to testify, if the Lord has made a way for you this morning, and you wasn't even looking for it, and you need the Lord to show up right now, The best way to put it in his hand is to give God some praise. And I don't know what you came to do, but I need some more bread in my basket. I need some more basket in my bread. I need some more basket in my overflow. I need the Lord to keep blessing. I need an overflow blessing. I need an overflow breakthrough. If that's what you need today, the Lord has it for you. But y'all, the way to get it is to put it in his hand.
Yeah.
Tell him how much you love him.
Yeah.
Tell him how good he's been to you. Tell him that you thank him for making a way. And you don't care who's looking at you this morning. You don't care what somebody else thinks this morning. Because God has been good to me. And I'm about to holler right now. God has opened some doors to me. And I'm about to tell him thank you right now. God has made some ways for me. I'm about to not sit down right now. Because I'm getting ready to thank God for me. Now, if he hadn't been good to you, you might want to sit up and sit down. But if God has been good to you, why don't you grab your neighbor and tell him, you don't know, like I know, what the Lord has done for me. He put some clapping in my hand, some stomping in my feet, some money in my pocket, some joy in my heart. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he make the enemies your footstool? Won't he give you joy and sorrow? Won't he give you hope for the Lord? God bless y'all.